Hey, dude, the internet's kind of exploding. Are you gonna do this review or not? Oh, my God, that is depressing.
Fuck it. Really? I mean, you saw how that second-to-last chapter went. I don't even want to see how it ends. Fuck it. Fuck the whole thing. I'm done. Just let me lay here and remember better times. Like, Grimmjow coming back, but he didn't do shit. And then fucking Cell. Are you a girl or a guy? What, we never got a fucking answer on that. God.
Hey, I don't mean to interrupt your grieving period, but you do know this isn't the last chapter, right?
Wait, I'm sorry, what?
Yeah, turns out the next chapter is actually going to be the last one. And also, I hear through the grapevine there's going to be a special announcement.
Are you serious? What announcement? What is it?
No, I don't know. New anime project, a movie, data book, sequel to the manga, or maybe Kubo just got a really good deal on Beverly Hills 90210 and he's just really excited to share the information with everybody.
Holy shit, so is there an actual chance that a phoenix might rise from the ashes from all this? I'm gonna toss away these chains of melancholy. I'm gonna get up right now and I'm gonna... fuck it.
Oh, God damn it. Okay, look, that was the best pep talk I could conceivably have given to another human being, so if you don't get up in the next 15 seconds, I'm just gonna cut your arm off, so...
Oh, no, you did fine, don't worry about that. It's just, look at this place, it's fucking wrecked. I took down all my pictures, my freaking backdrop's all gone. I honestly thought last time would be it, so I just kind of went crazy. I mean, what do you expect to happen? A random time skip to the future where everything's set up back perfectly without any buildup or-
Wow! I can't believe it's been 1 hour already! Can you believe that? All that crazy shit that happened in between? Oh. Anyway, buddy, you want to stick around and do the review with me or what? It's the second to last chapter, come on! Nah, I'm good. I gotta go work on my coin collection, but you have fun, Chief. Alright, hey everybody, Tekking101 here, hit review chapter 685 of Bleach, the penultimate chapter, the true penultimate chapter. You may notice that I like saying the word penultimate. I mean, come on, it's so cool to say. You don't get a chance to say it that often, you know? Does anyone remember the Series of Unfortunate Events books? You know, whatever, it's not important. Anyway, chapter starts off with a cover page in color! Remember that? Remember when every time there was a color page in Bleach, I would shout to the heavens that there was a color page? Kind of brings back all those little memes and little running gags I had in the videos way back in the day. I don't do them anymore. I don't know. I wonder what happened to them all. Anyway, yeah, so it's a pretty cool color page, I have to admit. Ichigo standing there with his new Bankai / old Shikai, however you want to go about it. Along with that, you also see the text that says that Ichigo is standing firm across the test of time. Well, I mean, not really. I mean, if he was like 1,000 years old, okay, then he would be standing the test of time. But this series has only been going on for, what was this, 15 years. 15 years, because, wait, Ichigo means Ichigo. Oh, son of a bitch! Kubo, did you plan that shit? He fucking planned that shit! I don't even get it. He might have been rushed by Jump recently, but you know for a fact, like 10 years ago, he was like, maybe I'll keep this series going until 15. That makes sense, because Ichigo's name means 15. It's not that funny. Okay, so the first page of the chapter starts off with... He's sitting in front of...
Attention! Attention! This is not a test. This is the Shonen Jump Emergency Broadcast Service. There will be a special announcement for Bleach, next chapter, to conclude the series. You may now begin speculating on the return of the anime in the comments below. This has been the Shonen Jump Emergency Broadcast Service. We now return you to your regularly scheduled screaming idiot.
crazy, right? And don't even get me started on the sex toys. Alright, so to begin this chapter proper, we see Shunsui sitting in front of a shrine or like in a little monument in some part of the Seirite. We don't really know what's going on there. He's just sitting there sipping some sake, stating that everything's begun to wrap up finally. The reconstruction of the Soul Society is underway. So we're having a flash forward to the future, and it's about 10 years. That's right, 10 years since last chapter. I know it was abrupt and all of a sudden, you know, like last chapter, Ichigo just cuts Yuha in half, and we don't even know, like, you know, at least a confirmation if Yuha was defeated. You know, what happened to Ichigo after the battle? What happened to Aizen after the battle? You know, what about the Varveld or the Soul Palace? Did it go back to being the way it is? It's just kind of jarring that we don't get any buffers, but, you know, it's in a rush, so whatever. I guess we gotta hurry up and skip 10 years into the future, which is what I expected. I think a lot of people expected we were gonna get something like that. So, yeah, the Seirite itself is pretty much the same. Except for the giant fucking Sokyoku scaffold they built now. I mean, what the hell else would you call that? Now, to be fair, the Sokyoku Hill did get destroyed in the last chapter when Yuha was using his shadow powers. It wrecked the entire area, and it was already damaged when Ichigo, you know, destroyed it. It wasn't, like, repaired or anything. We still saw it was broken half, and the freaking hole was still there, as well as half the hill was taken out by Yuha. So they clearly reconstructed it back to the way it was, even greater than before. I really hope that thing is, you know, having use, because it takes up, like 10% of the fucking Seirite now. I hope that someone's living in it, at least. But, because it's like a giant execution platform, basically. Just like, yeah, you don't fuck with the Seirite. You know, last time the Quincy's fucked with the Seirite, look what happened to them. Anyone wants to fuck with us now? We got a giant execution stand right here. It's got your name on it, fucking hollow piece of shit. Anyway, Shunsui is stating, yeah, time does fly by, and, you know, they just have to lay one more brick, and everything's gonna be set and ready and peachy keen, and everything's good to go. So, right around this time, we then see an unknown figure, it's probably Nanao, who's stating, Captain Commander, we're out of time, we gotta pick up the pace. I tell you, Nanao, I know way too well where this is going. Man, oh man, some people just can't appreciate the pace at which I move. You could learn a thing or two from this old mountain man. You know what? I know a lot of people have been saying that Kubo put a secret message in this review, and it was right around this panel. Now, I've read this panel like 8-9 times, and I haven't figured out anything yet. But I'm gonna figure this shit out. Trust me. Using my intense Bleach intellect that I've gathered across the aeons, or 5 years, I'm going to piece this shit together. I'm gonna find out what Shunsui, and by extension Kubo, is really trying to say here. After an undetermined amount of time, I figured it out. I've cracked the case. The message that Kubo wants his loyal fans to know after 15 years is... Ain't nobody got time for that?
Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time. Ain't nobody got time for that. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Right, so yeah, it's kind of hard not to look at this as a jab at Shonen Jump. You know, like, come on, you people don't know anything about my pace. I got this pace I'm doing, and you're just wrecking it. You know, though, I will say, it's kind of lighthearted here, the expression that Shunsui has. It's just like, yeah, well, you know, maybe something else will happen afterwards. I don't want to get your hopes up. I really don't. I've been pretty depressing about this, so I guess I should give a little glimmer of possibility, considering that this page is so glaring, like, Bleach is ending, big news, but equally big news, you have this announcement. Now, it's happened before where mangakas have left their magazines and gone to other magazines to finish their series. I'm not saying it's happening. I'm not even saying I believe in that 100%. I have no better idea than you do, but it's happened before. It's a possibility. That's all I'm saying. Okay. Continuing onward. Shunsui begins to walk away, and we find out that the place he was sitting was in fact a grave. And whose grave was it? Well, it was Uketake's. So yeah, Uketake's confirmed to be deceased, and I think everybody could have figured that out. I mean, he was always a pretty sickly guy, and apparently he said that the only thing keeping his illness at bay was the Mimihage inside of him. Mimihage left, and, you know, U-Haul ripped it out, and he got, like, forcibly removed from his body. He wasn't looking too hot. You know, honestly, I might have been... I mean, I know this might piss a lot of people off, but I might have been a little bit more pissed off if Uketake lived, considering, you know, he would have the illness inside of him unabated for years, and he would still be fine, you know? So, whatever. But that does bring into a question, considering that he used the Mimihage to stabilize the Soul King, and then, of course, U-Haul became the Soul King, but then U-Haul was defeated... Who the fuck is the Soul King? You know, like, easy fucking... I mean, I don't know. Like, the Soul King, if there was no Soul King, the entire universe, like the Don Guy, the Quakemundo, Living World, Soul Society, all of that would crumble. And we've seen that happen. We've seen that, like, when in those brief moments, it was only a few moments between Soul Kings, when, you know, the first Soul King died and before U-Haul absorbed the next one, it was only a brief moment in between then, but we saw that there was, like, massive earthquakes in all three dimensions, including the Don Guy, the Precipice World. So... Everything's stable, and it's been stable for 10 years, so who's the new one? I don't know, maybe we'll find out. Anyway, yeah, so Nanao keeps calling Shunsui over, and then he leaves the tomb and says, you know, don't worry, Uketake, we'll be back, and we can, you know, we can talk some more then. However, as they're walking away, we see the pavement, the tiles that make up the ground of the Soul Society, and we see a very familiar little shadow begin to bubble up underneath, between a crack. I see. You know what this means, guys? I'll tell you what it means. This means... piglets! You might be thinking that wasn't relevant, but in fact it was, because my neighbor just got a little piggy named Penelope, and so I'm walking to go get the mail this morning, and then this freaking pig, just little tiny, like, 6-inch nothing little piglet starts to waddle over to me to try to, like, chase me off its property. I'm like, oh no, cute little pig's attacking me. Please don't snort at me, little pig. Alright, so we get the title page, A Perfect End. Okay, I know for a fact Kubo's not saying that within the context of the series. You know, like, this is Kubo's perfect ending to Bleach. Yep, everything worked out great. Every single thing he wanted to be in this series, he put in, and everything worked out great. Storybook fucking ending, a perfect end. So, we should probably look at other definitions in the context of this chapter. I'll get more into that near the end, but just keep in mind how fucking picturesque and, as I said, storybook this ending is. It's almost like that you just basically take that old phrase, happily ever after, and, you know, I mean, it sucks that Uketake's dead and stuff, but, you know, for considering all the shit that happened this arc, this is happily ever after in its purest fucking context. So, just tuck that back in your mind, and we'll get to that. So we cut over to the research and development division that looks like it had a little bit of an upgrade since the last time we saw it, where we see Mayuri. Now, keep in mind, it's been 10 years, so I think we can expect a Mayuri mask change. I just want you guys to keep in mind what we've been working with up till now. Okay, so this was Mayuri's first design when he appeared in Turn Back the Pendulum at his earliest point, and then later on, during a flashback, probably 50 years ago, at some point between Turn Back the Pendulum and when Ishin was the captain, this was the mask or the face paint he wore, and then of course there's the design he had at the beginning of the series, and then of course there's the design when he went to Wakamundo, and then there's the design at the beginning of this arc, and then here's his light armor that he wore throughout the majority of the last arc. So, with all that in mind, here is Mayuri Kuratsuchi's final design, probably, in the Bleach series. So what do you think? I honestly still think that the Pharaoh one is probably my favorite, because that's just absolutely ridiculous. I mean, yeah, the one he had at the beginning of the last arc, of this arc, with the giant headdress that went down to, like, his lower back, and he had to paint the Squad 12 emblem on the back of it, that was pretty out there, too, but I still like the Pharaoh one the most. That was the coolest design for me. This one designs, it looks more like devil horns he has, sort of like a demonic appearance going on there, so that's pretty cool, I guess. Right, so it's pretty much just business as usual with the repairs. He's basically just looking at the reports and he's just like, oh, okay, this the 55th block is finally finished. We should probably swing over and just make sure it meets our, you know, expectations and everything. Come along, Namuri Hachigo. Oh my god, it's Chibi Nemu! It's so kawaii! Yeah, so, of course, Nemu got completely destroyed by Pernida. She got her entire body, like, destroyed, except for her brain, of which Mayuri managed to salvage and then maintain. Now, since it's obviously just a brain that was left outside of, you know, any sort of fluid, it was probably dead immediately, but it did have Nemu's DNA in it, which, of course, that's what Mayuri was after. The whole point of it was Mayuri was trying to create a perfect being that could maybe, like, that was the whole point of, like, Shinigami. Shinigami creating life. That's what they should aspire towards. They're gods, after all. Then he failed 6 times in a row, and then you get to Nemu, who was the Namuri Hatanago, the number 7, and she not only achieved the criteria of being able to survive and become, like, on the level of a Shinigami, she was able to transcend that. During her fight with Pernida, it was pretty clear that she reached all new levels, and that's what made Mayuri so happy. Like, I finally succeeded. I finally defeated Uehara at something. So, took her brain and then, I guess, extracted the DNA from it, the raw materials, and then created the next in line, which would, of course, be Namuri Hachigo. Yeah, so, I'm pretty sure it's a completely new specimen. None of the former memories that, you know, the last Nemu had, and let's just ignore the fact that Mayuri basically creates little girls off of a assembly line. Let's just ignore that for the moment. But she's really cute, and the potential for what she would have when she grows up is the sky's the limit for her, basically. Damn, I mean, Nemu would have probably kept on, you know, increasing her power as long as she didn't get killed by Pernida, but this is the next step, so Mayuri probably made some enhancements there. I don't know what the hell's gonna happen, but it would be pretty cool to see her in the, you know, all grown up. But anyway, yeah, so Mayuri and her walk out of the 12th Division, and he, you know, berates her a little bit. Like, I told you not to shout like that. Where did you get that? I know it wasn't from your mother, because I am your mother. But no, he loves her. We all know at the last of the fight, you know, he has some affection for her, even though he puts up that persona. And he's still calling her by her name, you know, Namuri Hachigo. And, you know, with Nemu, it was like he would call her Namuri Nanago for a while, but then after a while, just started calling her Nemu Kurotsuchi. But anyway, so next scene, we see Kenpachi, Yumachika, and Ikkaku wandering through the Soul Society, trying to get to the new captain inauguration ceremony. Ooh, a new captain! I wonder who it could be. I have no idea. But yeah, it turns out that ever since the incident with Yachiru, obviously she's not around anymore. Ikkaku is the new vice-captain of the Squad 11, which I don't think anyone would have been surprised by that. Although that's really good news for Yumachika, because remember Yumachika, he always wanted to be the third seat because he finds the character of three to be the most beautiful. But of course, that belongs to Ikkaku. So I took number 5. 5 being close in appearance to the number 3 in the Japanese kanji, of course. So yeah, so of course, now Ikkaku is now the lieutenant. Yumachika would now be the third seat. I'm surprised that Yumachika, he's wearing like a cloak, that he wouldn't just put the number 3 on the back of the cloak, because that would be kind of something that he would do. But anyway, we don't really know if they're brought up to speed about the whole Yachiru thing. I would assume that, you know, they know how Kenpachi is. I assume that, you know, Ikkaku and Yumachika, you know, they maybe met with Kenpachi after the battle, and Kenpachi told them, you know, okay, Ikkaku, you're the new lieutenant, and Ikkaku's like, what about Yachiru? And either Kenpachi told them what happened with Yachiru, or he was just like, shut the fuck up, you know, don't worry about her, whatever. And, you know, Ikkaku and Yumachika would not press the issue. That's their captain. They know how he is. They'd be like, okay, sir, thank you for the honor. I'll be the new lieutenant. And then fucking Yumachika pops in like, I can be third C, right? And Kenpachi's like, yeah, fuck, sure, I don't care. You know, it's just, I was like, yay, I finally get it. So, yeah, but he's stating that, you know, they can't get lost, of course, because it was Yachiru the one that, you know, made them always lose direction. You know, Yachiru was always telling Kenpachi which way to go, and he would always listen to her, but now that she's not around anymore, they can never get lost. You know, soundless, you know, logic there, flawless. So apparently, they thought that it was in the 1st Division Barracks, which is where all the new captain ceremonies we've seen take place. But no, it's he thinks it's in the 13th Barracks because it's the new 13th Division Captain. Oh, 13th Division Captain. I wonder who it could be. Sentaro. It's probably Sentaro. I can't think of anyone else. But anyway, yeah, they rush off, and in the background, we see Shinji and Momo there, who are wondering, you know, where the fuck are they going? And Momo's like, maybe we should give them directions, and Shinji's like, nah, fuck it, they'll figure it out sooner or later. Nothing really much to add between these two. I thought that Shinji would have grown his hair out back to the way it was during Turn Back the Pendulum. Anyone else think that? I thought he was going to do that, but he didn't. His hair is the same length as he always had it. His appearance really didn't change at all. Momo, I think, has a little bit of a different hairstyle, but nothing really to comment on. So let's move on, I guess. The next scene, we cut over to, I guess, a training area where we see somebody jump off a fucking cliff and land on the ground. Now, come on, man. They just fixed the damn tiles. You asshole. I'm going to beat the shit out of... Oh, it's Iba. Right, so I guess Iba is trying to invigorate his men and train them by teaching them how to jump off a cliff and land with 2 feet on the ground without your kneecaps immediately shattering into fucking dust. Yeah, good job, buddy. Also, he's the new captain, so yeah, he's also got a pompadour, which I know a lot of people were saying, like, fucking Iba's captain, really? We hardly got anything from him, and I will admit, we have gotten shit from Iba, not just this final arc, but really at all. We don't even know what the fucking name of his fucking Shikai is, or his Zanpakuto, or what ability it has. He's used it like 3 times in the series, but every time he uses it, he always just releases it, and we never get to see the name of it. You know, he used it against Ikkaku, and then he used it against Ion. I think he used it in a few of the movies. But that was it. It has like a scimitar appearance with like little picks sticking out of it. And now he apparently knows Bankai on that son of a bitch, which would be really cool if we knew what it fucking did! But he has a pompadour, and as we all know, every fucking anime character in the history of forever that's had a pompadour, immediately badass. He's got a cool crescent scar there. He's sort of like a Yakuza boss. That's kind of what Iba's whole thing was. He has like that tonto thing sticking out of his belt, and he has a big, huge tattoo over his back, which is very indicative of Yakuza kind of culture over in Japan. They have the big tattoos on their backs. So, I can imagine Iba has now changed the entire 7 Division into basically a mob headquarters, you know, and just like, he's the boss. And as for Komamura, okay, look, we don't get confirmation he's dead. Last time we saw him, he was a dog or a wolf, whatever you want to say. He was walking around alongside Iba. So I'm not going to say he's dead. Screw it. You know what? Obviously, he couldn't continue his captain duties because he's, you know, an animal. You know, he can't even hold a sword. But we still see he has reason. I mean, he was, you know, after he turned into a dog, he was still thinking to himself, you know, man, this is what I deserve. I fell into this void of revenge just as toes, and I deserve to be turned into an animal. So he still has, like, human mental capacity anyway. So fuck it. Komamura is not dead. I'm imagining that Iba transformed, you know, the entire 7th Division into fucking Yakuza headquarters, and everyone calls him boss, and he sits up there on his awesome fucking chair, and he's got a big 7 logo behind him, and he's got Komamura sitting next to him as his, like, guard dog, you know, and he's, you know, just like there. He's like, you piss him off, he'll maul you. But anyway, next we have Toshiro and Rangiku heading, I guess, to the captain ceremony here. And they're talking about people that would become captain in the future, and they bring up Shuhei, who's running right next to them. And this is like a weird moment with Shuhei. Oh wait, Kensei's still alive! I just got that. I'm like, oh shit, Kensei. Okay, well, he's not a... Alright. I don't know. Alright, so if Kensei's still alive... Fuck Shuhei. Fuck it. He got shot in the chest and whatever. Fuck Shuhei. He knows Bankai, maybe, possibly, probably. Who cares? I mean, he kind of turns into a whining bitch in this chapter. He's just like, I didn't get a chance to use my Bankai, but I can do it, totally. Oh, man. But yeah, Kensei's still alive, which means, of course, Rose is still going to be alive. And Rangiku, of course, as well. But we didn't get a confirmation Rangiku died. Rangiku was just kind of... She showed up as a zombie. She might have been turned as the same as Toshiro. They were both transformed into zombies while they were still alive. But in the case with Kensei and Rose, Gremmy purportedly killed them, and then they were turned into zombies by Giselle. So I can conceive of 3 possibilities here. Number 1... Gremmy really sucks at using his power. Number 2, Giselle's really good at using hers. Or 3, Mayuri could just straight up resurrect the fucking dead. Who am I kidding? We all know the answer's 3. Right, so Shuhei could probably use Bankai, but whatever, who cares? Toshiro brings up the fact that he hasn't, you know, used his Bankai or hasn't had a chance to use his Bankai in so long is because for the past 10 years, nothing has happened. The peace we've enjoyed has been unbroken. Storybook ending. Or is it? I don't know. Okay, and I guess, why not? I don't know whenever I'm gonna get a chance to talk about this. I'll talk about the possibilities of Shuhei's Bankai. Fine! I know a lot of people are curious about that, but let's talk about Shuhei for one moment, okay? Let's talk about something else. Remember the first time he released his Shikai? You know, he's fighting against Findor, and he had him in that water prison no jutsu shit, and he was like, Reap, Kazeshini, or Kai, Kazeshini, and then rips the whole thing apart, and you have that moment where it's really cool, and it's like, holy shit, dual scythe blades? What the fuck? And then he raises one of them up, and he's like, this is my Zanpakuto, Kazeshini. But I don't like it very much. And Findor's like, what do you mean? He's like, just look at the shape of it. It looks like something that's meant to reap life. Okay. Shuhei, what are you? That's not a trick question. I'm not trying to fuck with you. I'm just like, what are you? What would you specify your existence as? Like, I'm human, okay? Human. Human, okay? I am human. What are you? Shinigami, yeah! And what is the literal translation of Shinigami? Tell him, Ryuk!
Death God?
Yes! Death God! Fucking death! And yeah, Willem Dafoe is Ryuk, can you fucking believe it? But no, yeah, Death God! Holy shit! Your one fucking job is to reap souls, or perform Konso, or bring them back! Like, that's your whole fucking job! And you're just like, I don't like to take life. I'm like, fuck off, Shuhei. Fuck off. Eat a bag of dicks. You know what's funny? Shuhei has this big crush on Rangiku, if anyone's ever followed the extra supplementary chapter shit. He has this huge crush on Rangiku. You know, fuck it, you're too much of a bitch for Rangiku. Rangiku would destroy you, Shuhei. One night, if they ever actually got together, she would fucking just destroy you, okay? You're not even close to that level yet, alright? Maybe Momo. That's a good target, but not Rangiku. Holy shit. God, you're a wuss. Okay, so, going over to the First Division Barracks, where we see Soyphone! I don't give a fuck, but hey, it's good to see her again, because last time we saw her was when they walked into the Varvelt with Shunsui's group, and they were walking, and then, you know, Shuhei got shot by Lilia, and then next time we see the group, Soyphone's just not part of it. And Shunsui mentions, oh man, a bunch of people got shot. I guess Soyphone was one of those people that got shot. You'd figure that being the captain of the fucking Stealth Corp, she'd be able to avoid gunfire, but I guess not. Yeah, so I want that, but or she ran off and, no, that's not what she would do. She wouldn't run off and hide. Maybe she went off to try to fight the enemy on her own, but just never managed to encounter them. Maybe she went to go find Yoruichi, but just never could find him. Her. I don't know. But yeah, Soyphone's here. Whatever. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on her because I don't give a shit. But anyway, Kenpachi arrives. Yukaku and Yumachika are behind him. They're fucking exhausted, so they were probably running around the entire length of the Seirete. Soyphone and Kenpachi sort of have kind of like a moment. Oh, cut her in half. Cut her in half, please. Please, it's cool. You're not going to do it. Whatever, it's fine. Oh, man. Well, I guess we can't all have our perfect ends to our series. Such tragedy. Alright, so we get a look at the new captain of the 4th Division. It's Isane, who has rocking a new hairstyle there, and she's looking very submissive as she always is. She just kind of like waddles up to Kenpachi and Soyphone, like, okay, now let's just go inside and let's just do it. Her lieutenant is her sister, Kiyone Kotetsu, who, you know, berates her for not being, you know, like, you know, you're a captain now. You should have sort of like an elegance here. Like, that's kind of the same thing as Unohana. Which, by the way, I'm a little bit distraught that Kiyone is her fucking lieutenant. Like, yeah, I get it, they're sisters, but Hanatsuro. I mean, come on. Hanatsuro, that would have been fucking perfect. Like, yeah, Hanatsuro is captain, that might have been a stretch, but come on! It works on so many levels. Like, he was introduced in the Soul Society arc, we've seen him grow, you know, from a little bitch to, like, a slightly less bitch. You know, he's had a few moments, a few shining moments in the series, you know? Let's see here, his older brother was fucking lieutenant of the 4th Division back, Senosuke, was the former lieutenant back during Turn Back the Pendulum. It would have worked on so many levels to make him lieutenant. Maybe they offered it to him and he's just like, no, I don't want to do it. But, you know, seriously, that would have been perfect. Why Kiyone? Why the fuck Kiyone? Does she even know how to heal? 4th Division, you know, basic knowledge of healing would be nice. Kiyone, who just, you know, member of the 13th Division. Honestly, I'm thinking that Kubo might have thrown her in as being lieutenant, Just because if he didn't, we might not have even known that was Isane, because the hair looks so different. I admit it kind of threw me off at first, but, you know, Kiyone kind of cued me up. But even then, I'm like, eh. Okay, so now we finally get into the big scene with all the captains, and we get to finally see, you know, who's there, who isn't there, who's new, who isn't. Okay, so the first division, of course, is the same. We have Okikiba and Nanao, who are both the lieutenants, and then we have Shunsui as the head captain. Soifone is still the captain of Squad 2. I can assume Omaido would still be her lieutenant. Rose, once again, as I said, is alive, the same as Kensei, and he is still the captain of Squad 3. Izuru... no idea with Izuru. I don't think you can see him, but he's down there. You know, Cyborg Izuru, I don't know if he's still there or not. I don't know, but, you know, I could assume since he's still alive, why else would Kubo show him is still alive? He's probably still the lieutenant of Squad 3. Squad 4, as I said, is Isane and Kiyone. Squad 5 is Shinji and Momo. That hasn't changed. Squad 6 is Byakuya, as well as Renji. We're going to see him in a little bit. And also, there's a lot of questions why Renji didn't want to get promoted to the captain's seat, because obviously he has the level for it. I can honestly see Renji just being perfectly happy with working under Byakuya. I mean, why not, right? I mean, that's the guy he's kind of looked up to and wanted to surpass. You know, I could see them offering him the position, but he was just like, you know, the person who got the position deserves it more than me. I'm fine with being with Byaki. I'm fine with being, you know, in his service. You know, you don't have to take up the position if you don't want to. Squad 7, of course, is Iba. We do not know who the lieutenant is, but I do know that during the turn back to the pendulum, Sentaro Kotsubaki's older brother was the former lieutenant of Squad 7, under Love. So, I can either assume two possibilities. Either Love is the new lieutenant, which that would make no fucking sense if he wasn't just the new captain, so probably not very likely, or it's Sentaro. And that would make sense considering Kiyone is the new lieutenant of Squad 4, Sentaro would become the new lieutenant of Squad 7 in the footsteps of his father. Love, I guess, just didn't give a fuck and just wanted to stay home in the world of living reading manga all day. I honestly think he might have made the better move. We get a new captain for Squad 8, Lisa! Lisa's the new captain of Squad 8! That's something I like to call Shonen Cliché number 63. It's kind of a little-known one, but it's the cliché where you have, like, a big question that you wonder, and it's just answered in kind of, like, a lackluster way. It's like, wow, we have all these gaps in the Gotei 13. Who's gonna be the new captain of Squad 3 and 9? Oh, Kensei and Rose are still alive. Oh, man, well, who's gonna be the new captain of Squad 8? We don't even know anyone. Oh, it's Lisa. Okay, I think I was expecting a little bit more something epic than that, but whatever. I also especially love that Lisa, despite having this really high-ranking position that, you know, in honor in 1,000 years of Soul Society history, Shunsui's like, I bestow you with the captaincy of Squad 8. It will be in your care. And Lisa's just like, goes out and buys a fucking She-Hawk show exposing her midriff because she's very lecherous and perverted. That's just kind of how she is. And so, yeah, you look at Toshiro. Toshiro's even kind of looking away at her. She's like, I can't look at her. I turn around, it's her stomach's right there. Her perfectly chiseled toned stomach and curves in her body. And oh my god, Lisa's fucking hot. Like, let's just say that. I mean, she is, you know, bae. Okay, anyway. Yeah, Squad 9, Kensei and Shuhei. Squad 10, Toshiro Rangiku. Squad 11, Kenpachi and Ikkaku. Squad 12, we don't see here for whatever reason, because they're out, you know, surveying the area, but we saw them, Mayori and Namori Hachigo, which gives us to the 13th Division. We see Renji there, who's speaking to the person that's going to be entered into the captaincy. We see he has a braid in his hair now, so, you know, take that whatever you will. And now announcing the new captain of Squad 13, Rukia! Yes! I knew you could do it, girl! I knew you could do it! She also kind of looks a lot more like Isane now, but I knew you could do it! Rocking the long hair, you're blushing, oh, she's nervous, she's all kawaii and shit. Okay, so we get that epic moment there, and then we cut to the last scene of the chapter over in the 12th Division Barracks, where we see Akon is the new lieutenant of Squad 12. Sorry, not the new Nemu, I guess because she's too young for it yet. But yeah, Akon took up the seat as the new lieutenant of Squad 12. But he's there, and he's with Hyosu, and he's just, like, talking about, like, something going on in the Seirete, and he's like, what's up? And they look at their instruments, and it's something odd. It appears that a Ryatsu that's nearly identical to Yuha's is appearing in the Seirete. And of course, it hasn't appeared for, you know, the last 10 years. And then, of course, we see the next chapter. the epic conclusion with an all-out color spread. Oh, Kubo's going all out on this one. Yeah, just gonna squirt that color all over the place. Anyway, yeah, so that's the end of the chapter. Now, look, I've already made a video announcing all of this, you know, card up there. I've gone through, you know, how odd it is ending your penultimate chapter with a cliffhanger like this and the nature of the big ultimate announcement, so I'm not gonna go too much into that. But I am going to say, as I said, this is a storybook ending. This is a perfect end. Don't trust this. That's all I'm saying. Do not trust this shit as far as you can throw it. Okay? I think Kubo's trying to be doing something here. I don't know what he's doing, but it's just, I'm seeing signs. Big announcement that's on the level of Bleach ending. You know, this cliffhanger on your second to last chapter, this little secret little jab at Shonen Jump, I don't know. I'm just saying that Kubo, he's always been a more poetic kind of guy, you know, and he delves a lot into symbolism and stuff, you know, takes a lot of inspirations from other literary sources. I'm not writing him out to be like the next fucking Shakespeare. I'm just saying there's a lot of like allegory and stuff in the way he writes. Okay, it's a little bit more complex. It delves a little bit more into philosophy than like, I don't know, One Piece does. Okay, and One Piece does do that from time to time, but I think Bleach does it a little bit more often. You know, I think Kubo is trying to, you know, have a little bit of elegance with his story. It might seem like I'm just trying to jerk him off, but my point is, with all knowing all of that about Kubo, the way he's ending it, if he just ends it with, like, everybody's happy now. All the captains are good, everybody's smiling, Rookie is captain of Squad 13, and everyone's been defeated, and everything's awesome, and peace and prosperity reigns throughout the land for 1,000 years. That does not seem like Kubo to me. Not in the slightest. Now, next chapter, we're probably going to get some, you know, what's going on with Ichigo, what's the haps with him, and stuff like that, but, as for this, the whole Yuha Ryatsu thing, I've heard a few theories about this. Number one, it is Yuha returning in the series, might, you know, continue in some form. Number two, it's just Uketake. It's something to do with him, because Uketake, it happened at Uketake's grave where we see the little bubble come up. You know, and maybe he's going to be the new Soul King. That was one way of looking at it. My theory is that it was Aizen. Aizen, you know, got pulled down to the shadows by Yuha, and after Yuha was defeated, Aizen spent the last 10 years trying to absorb the Soul King back into himself, and so he could become the Soul King, you know? And what are they fucking going to do? You know, he's the Soul King. And then also you have the fourth one, which is that this is actually a setup for that Yuha made 10 years ago. Remember when Yuha, back in chapter 680, said, you know, I will not just kill you, I will find the moment in your life where you feel the most joy, where happiness reigns across the land, where, you know, look at that, because everyone, even Toshiro said, man, we've had peace. Everybody's content. You know, Rukia is the new captain, Renji's happy, Byakuya is happy, fucking Kenpachi's content, even with Yuchiru, Shunsui's even content, even though Uketake's gone. Everyone just seems, this is like right at the cusp of the Soul Society being repaired, this shit goes down. Right when everyone's like, okay, Soul Society's fixed, everything's back to normal. Right at that fucking moment. Don't trust it. Not for a second. Not for a fucking last second, okay? Alright. Well, this'll be me, Tekking101. This is a long-ass review, but a lot of stuff to cover, obviously. So, yeah, this is it, guys. You know, I feel a little bit more better about this now. More better? Yeah, that's a phrase. But better about this than last week. You know, when we thought that this was going to be the last chapter, anyway, I felt like, oh man, there's just so much shit, but I don't know. Kubo might try to get squirrely on us here, so I'm gonna hold out my expectations until we really see what's going on. But yeah, there will not be a chapter of Bleach this week. It's on break. Next week it'll be out. The week of the 18th is when it'll be out. The Thursday where I am. Anyway, now I am still gonna do a live reaction to that chapter, the same as I did with the last one. This one anyway. Now here's the problem though. Chapter comes out, let's say, August 18th. I go back to college on the 22nd, so I don't know how that review's gonna work, but I'll figure out something. But yeah, also, as for the special announcement, you know, I don't see it being a movie. You know, people have been throwing that out there. Maybe the movie's going to continue the story. I don't see that happening. You know, like, okay, so there was no Bleach movie for years, and now there's just going to be this random Bleach movie that's going to pick up where the manga left off. I don't see that being the case. There seems to be a little bit too much hype for it to be like a data book or a fan book. So I want to say, I'm going to put my money on either announcement that the anime is coming back or some kind of manga sequel. I honestly, I've been racking my brain. I can't think of anything else that would warrant this big of a fucking announcement. You know, I don't see it just being like, oh yeah, here's a new fan book or here's a new data book. That just seems like way too much build up. So, yeah, I'll see you back here for the last chapter of Bleach. Dabble signing out!